Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to talk about how to use geometry nodes to create the basic crystals that I used for the video you can see in front of you. The tutorial on how to create the animated crystals is a separate tutorial. I decided to split them in two because there's a simpler way to create the crystals that I'm going to do, which is just basically modeling them. And then you can use those in the geometry node setup that I used to create this animation. Or you can create the relatively complicated node setup that I did to create the crystal structure itself. The advantage to using geometry nodes to create the crystal structure is that it allows you a lot of flexibility and you can change it, and you could even change it over time. So this video is specifically about the creation of the crystals themselves, the basic crystals that are used in that animation. I'll link on the video now to the main tutorial, which takes this basic crystal and animates it. In that tutorial, I will show that you can also do it with simply modeling some crystals as well. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. Feel free to comment or ask questions or even dislike the video. And if you don't like the video, I'd be very interested to see what the issues you spotted were so that I can improve going forward. If you're a Patreon supporter, I do upload these files for any use available to my Patreon supporters, and I upload tutorials quite regularly. So let's start the tutorial. So to begin with, we need some geometry of some description so that we can put the geometry nodes into it. It doesn't really matter what it is, but we'll just add a plane. And then I'll open a new window up and we'll go to the geometry node editor and we'll just say new up there. I'm going to call this crystal. And if we go to here, we can see it's still called geometry nodes up there. So we'll call that crystal as well, just to avoid confusion. So I always tend to add under geometry, a join geometry node into here. This is so that we can preserve this geometry here, even when we are adding geometry nodes in. We don't necessarily need that, but it just allows you to easily select the object that has the geometry node. So first of all, I'm going to add under mesh primitives, a mesh circle. And you can see if I just drop that there, our original plane has actually disappeared. So that's what the join node is for. I can put it back there. So as you can see, that's created a simple circle. I'm going to say fill type triangles, and I'm going to say vertices 6. You can now see we've just got a hexagonal shape in there. We'll leave the radius at 1 meter at the moment. And then I'm going to add, we'll use the search button this time, an extrude mesh node. Drop that in there. And you can now see that's extruded it up. I'm just going to come over here, turn on cavity, which just makes it a little easier to see shapes. And while we're here, I'm going to take that offset scale, which is effectively how far it extrudes it, to here, which gives us an input here that we can easily control the size of our extrusion. But I'll press N and bring up the node properties, and we'll just change that to height. We'll just change the name. So this is a controllable parameter now that we can easily control here. I'm going to make that quite a bit bigger, I think. We'll take it up to something like that. And you may want crystals with a flat top like that. So now we want to shape the top somewhat. So I'm going to add a set position node and we'll drop that in there. And by default, it's just going to, as you can see, move the object. It's transforming it effectively. But I actually don't want it to move the whole object. I want it to move parts of the object. So we need to get the index of specific points. And because I set this to triangles, you can see we've got this triangular shape. If I set that to n-gon, you can see we've just got a flat surface there. But by having it on triangles, we've got that central vertex as well. So we basically want to lift that central vertex up. So I'm going to add an index node. And what that's going to do is capture the index. It's a little bit weird how this works. It may make more sense to you, but it's essentially it's looking at the nodes that are just before, and if it makes sense, it will use the indices that come from that node. It's a little bit tricky for non-programmers, coders, to get your head around, I think, but nevertheless. So I'm now going to add, under utilities, a compare node, and this is going to compare two values. I'm going to put the index into one side. I'm going to set it to integer because indices are simple integers. They're not point something for an integer. It's 1 or 2 or 3 and so on. And I'm going to set that to 6. And then I'm going to say is equal to. So if the index is 6, this gives a true result. Otherwise, it gives a false result. And then that goes into selection. And if I now adjust the Z, we're actually moving the wrong point. It's currently moving the point at the bottom, but we need to untick individual here. Essentially, it was creating more indices by doing that. And by unticking individual, can now see that that 6 works. If you select any other number, not quite right. But this model, 6 is the right number. So I'd like to bring the, what you might call pointiness out as well. So I'm going to add under vector, a combine XYZ, take that into there. That's actually it's set at 0 at the moment. But then just take the Z to that input there. And I called that pointiness. So now we can raise that up and you can see we can make our crystal more or less pointy. And then I just wanted a quick way to be able to scale the whole crystal. This joint geometry node will be important later because we're going to be adding more of these crystals together and we obviously want to keep them all. So I'm now going to add, we'll search for it, a transform node, and we'll just drop that into there, not into the whole geometry track. And I'm then going to just take scale out to there. But I'm going to change scale over here. Instead of being a vector, I'm going to change it to a float because I want all of the values, X, Y, and Z, to change simultaneously just to change the overall size of the crystal. So if we now increase that, you can see our crystal is getting larger and smaller there. So that's our basic crystal constructed. And what I'm now going to do, I'm going to create another of those join nodes and put that up there. Select none of the boxes and then select those nodes and just say group. There's all our inputs there. And if we come out of edit mode, we've got a node group here, which we can call base crystal or whatever we want to call it. And we've still got our overall setup here. So I'm going to cut those connections now. So here's our base crystal and I'll just take that, connect it into there. And we just need to increase that scale a little bit, some height on it and put some pointiness on it. It's because I cut these connections. These are not connected at the moment. It doesn't matter. So now what I want to do is distribute some points on that crystal. So I'm going to add, we search, distribute points on faces. And I'm going to drop that in there and you can see our crystal's vanished and it's been replaced with a lot of dots. So we need to put our crystal back by putting that into there. But you can see we've got dots all over the faces now. And it's up to you, but I use Poisson distribution and I'll just put the values I used as a starting point. So I used about 19 for the density max and a density factor of 0.05 and just a random seed. I've put that on there because we're going to do more than one of these. One thing to be aware of is the more geometry we create at this stage, the more geometry is then going to be instanced in our final animation in the other tutorial that this is going to apply to, which may be something you need to bear in mind. So we've got some points and we now need to add an instance on points. So that's the node outputting our points. This is the node that's going to create some instances based on that. So I've added that in there and there's nothing there at the moment. And at this point, I'm going to duplicate that crystal. This time though, it's very important. I'm going to click that little 2 in there so that they're independent. Because right now they share the same data, or they share the same data until you click that button. So that's now a unique node. They happen to have the same data in them at the moment. And I'm going to take that geometry output from that crystal node and drop that into instance. And you can see it's a bit of a mess at the moment. They're obviously huge. So let's drop the scale a little. So there we can see them as reasonable size crystals. We may want to adjust that, but that's given us our basic mini crystals instanced on top of our other crystal. And we can play around with the density factor, and the seed. But obviously it doesn't look quite right at the moment. We need to play with the rotation, for example. So if I take rotation out of here and just put it straight into rotation, that's actually not bad. As a starting point for our crystals, it's pretty fair. I decided I wanted to align them slightly. So I did a little bit more than that, but by default, that's not too bad. We might want to decrease the height a little bit on these crystals. They haven't grown as far. So if you just want to tweak that, I'm going to add under vector, a vector math node and drop that in there. And it's set to add by default anyway. And then I'm just going to subtract a little bit from the X value. And you can see what that's doing is it's tilting them upward, which is what I wanted to do. Something like that. Now, one of the things you'll notice is these crystals, the bottom of them doesn't look quite right. In fact, I'm going to make them a little taller, so we'll increase the height, but you can see they're increasing from the bottom. We really want them buried in this bigger crystal. The base crystal, we probably want to do this too as well, but this one here, the secondary node, we come back into here, into our transform node, and if we go to Z and we can actually offset it in a little bit like that, and there you go, that's now buried inside the main crystal. And all we've done there is we've effectively raised the origin point, which on this big crystal is here. So if I go to the, I'm pressing tab to go in and out of these groups, by the way. So if I select the main crystal here, press tab, go into that, come over to here, the translation. You watch the base relative to that little dot, which is the origin point. You can see that's now raising it up. So that sorted that out. And then it's up to you whether you want to do more. What I did want to do though is have some variation in the size of those subcrystals, as it were. So let's add under utilities a random value node. That's set to float because it's just scale that I want to change. So I want to change all of these values by the same amount. And we can just plug that into there. We can now see we've got a variety of different size crystals there. Just put a random seed of whatever on there. The idea of the seed obviously is it gives you a different distribution, but with all essentially the same parameters. And I can increase the max a little bit more. But what I also wanted was I didn't want lots of large crystals or any really large crystals at the top here. So if I disconnect that a moment, so they're all the same size again, I'm going to add, if we search for it, a position node. So this works a bit like the index node, but now it's determining where in the geometry we are in terms of the position, the XYZ position. So I'm now going to add under utilities a map range node. So this is going to map the values that come from our position node. So I'll put that into the value input from where they are to where we want them to be. So if I just plug that straight into scale, you can see what's happened now is everything at the bottom has become quite small and everything at the top has become quite large. Or stayed the same size as it was. So we actually want to invert the map range to start with. So let's put 1 here and 0 as max. So now you can see we've got larger crystals at the bottom, and then any crystals occurring higher up are smaller. So that is now mapped that we only want the larger crystals at the bottom. And then it's a matter of playing around with the exact ranges. I'll just put in what I used to begin with. So I put from minimum 0.8, so that none of the crystals are 0, to a maximum of 2.2, to a minimum there of 1.2, and a maximum of 0. There's no randomness per se. All that happens at the moment is that the crystals get smaller as they go up. But now to bring my random values back into it, I'm going to add under utilities bath node, drop that in there. We're going to change this to multiply. And then we're going to put our random value into the other side. So now we've got some randomness, the multiplier for the map range. So we'll still get some larger crystals higher up, but generally they'll be lower down. And I don't necessarily want any crystals at 0, so I'll just increase that minimum a little bit. And maybe I'll make the maximum a little smaller than it currently is. So we've got some randomness, but in general, most of the larger crystals will be lower down. And obviously we can play around with the overall scale here to give us what we want. I'm going to call a halt to it there because essentially what you can now do if you want to is add another level of crystals, essentially doing what we've just done here, instancing points and then crystals on this first level. You can just do it again to add more crystals, but this time on these smaller crystals. And I did do that and created 3 levels. It gave me a few challenges because when I started to instance a lot of versions of this, it created an awful lot of geometry, which slowed things down a little bit. What I also wanted to do is to be able to control the overall size of things. So it's worth connecting these nodes as we did before. However, that's fine for that one. But obviously we've got our sub-level of crystals here, these smaller crystals, and they've got a different value. So the easiest thing to do there is simply to add another math node, set it to multiply, and maybe we'll make that one at 0.5. So for height, we'll take that into there, and then the output goes to height. The multiplier is what controls its size relative to the big crystal. The overall height will be affected by this larger crystal. So you can see they're growing and shrinking with the larger crystal. And obviously you can do exactly the same thing with scale as well. So obviously that needs to be quite a bit smaller there. And now when we play with scale, they'll scale up and down. With pointiness, I would suggest you probably just want to use that value, because they probably need to have the same proportions, even if they're smaller. So now when we play with pointiness, the whole crystalline set does the same thing. And we can tweak some of these values to get what we want. And you can even pull these seed values out if you want to. So that's all there is to this tutorial. And now if you came out of the other one to go and have a look at how this node setup is done, I'd suggest you use the link on the screen now to go back there. Otherwise, you can just model something like this to your heart's content. Obviously, with modeling, you won't be able to change this in real time. The model will be the model. So if you just watch this tutorial to see how to create a geometry node crystal, then I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. The original file with the crystalline models will be available to my Patreon supporters as normal, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.